Good morning. A few announcements before we begin. Sin is just right around the corner. Our diocesan synod will be in Athens this year, and it will be during the last week of April. Anyone interested in heading out to beautiful Athens to see our synod, please talk to me. Registration for the synod itself is $110. If you just want to go to the banquet, that's $35. But it's a neat thing. Our goal is to alternate every year between Athens and here. But it's neat to see the pro-cathedral at St. Stephen's and in Athens. And it's always neat to see how the church operates, how the church makes decisions and things of that nature. So if you'd like to learn more about that, please talk to me and you'd be very welcome. The food drive is going well. I'm glad to see we have more bags this week. We dropped some yesterday. Please feel free to take anything in the parish hall. Take it to your place of work, take it to school, take it anywhere you'd like. And bring in as much as you can. This is the time of year. We tend to get, Salvation Army gets inundated around Christmas time. This time of year, though, they don't. And so as much as we can help them, we want to be there for them. As an aside, too, anytime you have any sacramental needs, please do make those known to me. If, for instance, you'd like to have the sacrament at home, please let me know. If you'd like to receive a holy oath here at the church, please let me know as well. I'm always available for that. Sometimes I can kind of get lost in the bustle of things, but I'm never too busy for that. Please call me, talk to me, and I'll make sure I'm available for that. There's only so much holding the Madeline I can do, so please call me. Though I can pretty much call that. And also the midweek service continues. Notice we did lose that time to 6:30 as the service begins, and 7 the class begins. And we're working our way to the prologue of John, I think it's been a really worthwhile class so far, so I do encourage all to attend if you can. And, of course, my name is Saturday is a fasting day, as pointed by the book of Common Prayer. Thank you. The Litany on General Supplication is found on page 54 of the Book of Common Prayer. Let us pray.
And be not angry with us forever. Please, dear, to preserve all who travel by land, by water, I made these to give and preserve to our use the kindly fruits of the earth, so that in due time we may enjoy them.
We beseech thee to hear us, good Lord.
That it may please thee to give us true repentance, to forgive us all our sins, negligences, and ignorances, and to endure us with the grace of thy Holy Spirit, to amend our lives according to thy holy plan.
We beseech thee to hear us, good Lord.
Son of God, we beseech thee to hear us.
Son of God, we beseech thee to hear us.
O Lamb of God, who takest away the sins of the world,
grant us thy peace.
O Lamb of God, who takest away the sins of the world,
have mercy upon us.
O Christ, hear us.
O Christ, hear us.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us.
We may put our whole trust and confidence in thy mercy, and evermore serve thee in holiness and pureness of living. Be thy honor and glory through our only mediator and advocate, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God, who has given us grace this time of our call to make our common supplications unto thee, and hath promised that when two or three are gathered together in thy name, thou wilt grant their request. Fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of thy servants, as they be most expedient for them, granting us in this world knowledge of thy truth, and in the world to come, life everlasting.
Amen.
The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost be with us all evermore.
Amen.
Please join us again in 340.
Thank you.
We beseech thee, Almighty God, mercifully to look upon thy people, that by thy great goodness they may be governed and preserved evermore, both in body and soul, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty, everlasting God, who hatest nothing that thou hast made, and dost live, forgive the sins of all those who are penitent, create and make in us new and contrite hearts, that we, worthily lamenting our sins and acknowledging our wretchedness, may obtain of thee, the God of all mercy, perfect remission and forgiveness. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end.
The epistle is written in the 9th chapter of Hebrews, beginning at the 11th verse. Christ being come, and high priest of good things to come, by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. For if the blood of bulls and of goats and the ashes of an heifer sprinkled the unclean, sanctified to purify the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? And for this cause is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death, for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the first testament, they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. We're in the visit.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus said, "Which of you convinceth me of sin? And if I say the truth, why do ye not believe me? He that is of God heareth God's words.
Ye therefore hear them not, because ye are not of God. Then answered the Jews and said unto him, Say we not well that thou art a Samaritan, and hast a devil? Jesus answered, I have not the devil, but I honor my Father, and ye do dishonor me. And I seek not mine own glory. There is one that seeketh and judgeth. Verily, verily, I say unto you, if a man keep my saying, he shall never see death. Then said the Jews unto him, Now we know that thou hast a devil. Abraham is dead and the prophets. And thou sayest, If a man keep my saying, he shall never taste of death. Art thou greater than our father Abraham, which is dead? And the prophets are dead. Who makest thou thyself? Jesus answered, If I honor myself, my honor is nothing. It is my Father that honoreth me, of whom ye say that he is your God. Yet ye have not known him, but I know him. And if I should say, I know him not, I shall be a liar like unto you. But I know him, and keep his saying. Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it, and was glad. Then said the Jews unto him, Thou art not yet 50 years old, and hast thou seen Abraham? Jesus said unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, Before Abraham was, I am. Then took they up stones to cast at him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple.
Praise be to Christ.
Our Lord, in His grace, and love, and in
May the words of my mouth, the meditation of our hearts, be always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
Amen.
By his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. Hebrews 9:12. To better understand today's reading from the book of Hebrews, we begin in the book of Exodus. We begin with blood. Specifically, the blood that was used to purify God's people after their liberation from Egypt. We read in Moses' second book, "And Moses sent young men of the children of Israel, which offered burnt offerings and sacrificed peace offerings of oxen unto the Lord. And Moses took half of the blood and put it in basins, and half of the blood he sprinkled on the altar. And he took the book of the covenant and read in the audience of the people. And they said, all that the Lord hath said we will do, and be obedient. And Moses took the blood and sprinkled it on the people, and said, behold the blood of the covenant, which the Lord hath made with you, concerning all these words." Exodus 24:5-8. It's difficult, but can we imagine for a moment how gruesome this scene must have been? The people of God standing before Mount Sinai covered in blood, worshiping an altar covered in blood. The chosen people, the promised hope for the world's salvation, covered in death before their heavenly liberator and judge. It must have been truly horrible. And that, of course, was the point. These buckets of blood were an unignorable symbol of what it would mean if the chosen people broke their solemn covenant with their Almighty Lord. The horrible screams of the unblemished sacrifices, the terrible smell of the burning animals, the disgusting personal contact with all that was left of the poor dead creatures was all designed to vividly portray the horrible effects of human rebellion against our Creator. As St. Paul tells us, the wages of sin are death, and this is a graphic illustration of that death. Death is hard to ignore when it is sprinkled on you and on your family's face and clothes and hands. Our lectionary of the Bible forces us to read about this every year. But we would probably prefer not to think about what appears to our modern sensibilities to be the gruesome and cruel rituals of a long dead past. This visceral reaction is born of centuries of work by Christians attempting to convince everyone from the Romans to the Vikings to your local tribal witch doctor to stop sacrificing animals or people to gods. Kind of a funny aside, the modern secular vegetarian and vegan movement would have been impossible without this centuries of work. And if you really want to make a secular vegan crazy, mention this fact. They love it. It's great. Nevertheless, what happened at the foot of Mount Sinai, or at the first Passover, or at the yearly slaughter of a lamb and a goat on the Day of Atonement, was indeed horrible and awful and cruel. But our judgment of these rituals and all the people involved in them stems from a false idea that we moderns are really any better, that our secular ideologies are anyways less covered in blood. They all tell us to cover ourselves in blood and be redeemed. I don't have time to list out every single political or tribal commitment we can make that can distract us from the will of God, but they all require of us to cover ourselves in blood and say, "This is the sacrifice that will save me." The greatest difference between our secular blood soap covenants and the Sinai covenant is that the Sinai covenant was brutally and piteously honest about what establishing heaven on earth would cost. On the other hand, if you ask, for instance, a secular political progressive how the world will be saved, they will tell you that through technology or education, all persons will be made equal. It'll be heaven on earth. But they don't tell you that equality will be soaked in the blood of millions of abortions every year. That isn't heaven. Or ask a secular political conservative, how will the world be saved? And they will tell you the world will be saved by exporting Western ideals to every corner of the world. But they don't mention that we're going to have to kill an awful lot of people who look at Western decadence or suicide rates or sexual slavery in our own continent and say, no thank you. We may look at the cult of the Old Testament, tabernacle and temple, and think, this has nothing to do with me. But in reality, have we not simply insulated ourselves from the realities of our own very bloody and sinful world? Have we fallen into the very trap that makes today's epistle supremely relevant and important for our lives? Remember, the original context of this letter to the Hebrews was a comprehensive warning. The great theologian John Owen called this the epistle of warning. It was a warning to all second-generation Jewish Christians who were tempted to fall back into the old temple worship, to embrace the shadows of things to come, rather than the light which now shines into the world. Is that us too? The short answer is yes. I know I constantly want to return to the false religion of the world and its comforts, to turn and follow the high priests of our culture, rather than trusting in the actual victory over evil and pain and suffering that was accomplished by the great high priest described in today's epistle. I know I always feel myself being called back to that comfort, back to what I more intuitively understand. Again, I do not particularly care at all how you vote or which cable news network you watch. I'm not coming to anyone's house and checking their DVR. That's not what this is about. What I do care about is what do we actually think will save the world? For it is that enterprise into which we will pour our hearts and our souls and our minds. Whoever we vote for, they can have your vote. That's fine. Christ demands our everything. And he can demand that. He can demand that because over and above what he has done, over and above who he is, over and above what people claim they are, he has actually earned it by being the everything the sacrificial system of the Old Testament was pointing us towards. He's earned it by being everything, every religious impulse or political impulse that drives us to try to save the world. He's everything, all of that inside of us was pointing us towards. The greatest tragedy that could befall us, the 40th generation of Christians, is to give our full allegiance to anyone other than that prophet, priest, and king who went to that cross for our sakes. That's Paul's warning from 1950 years ago, and it's our warning today. The great question laid on us in this text is, do we cover ourselves in blood, or do we trust in the blood of the one who covers us in his righteousness?
It's a question. But we may ask, why do I need a high priest anyway? Well, again, however we live our lives, we are already following some priest. The only question is, what priest are we following? We could follow the examples and teachings of our favorite movie star, or politician, or guru, or philosopher, or parent, or even preacher. We could live for ourselves and try to grab as much happiness as we can before we die. Or we can be saved by the God who created us and loves us and offers himself for our sins and for our dead works that we think might save us. Christ, as the true high priest, truly worthy of our love and worship, climbed onto the cross-shaped altar at Calvary. And just as the ceremonial lambs and goats and heifers that came before him foreshadowed, he offered his sinless life for the sinful men and women who have filled the generations of his church. That once-for-all sacrifice has forever changed the relationship between sin and death, because it is not us who are covered in blood and making promises we know we can't keep. It isn't us trying to save the world with our corrupt schemes and self-serving plans. No, it is Christ, covered in his own blood, keeping the promise the Son made to his Father. That loving promise within the Trinity, within the Godhead, ensures the creation of a new, resurrected world, whose first victorious member walked out of his powerless tomb on the first Easter day. That's no empty hope. That's a historical reality. Our vindicated Messiah has now ascended into the heavenly tabernacle, not made with hands, to fulfill three important functions intimately linked to his status as the last and greatest high priest. First, Christ represents us before the Father within the heavenly royal court. Our undeserved status as co-heirs in the new forever, already being established in our remade hearts, has real significance, not because we want it really badly. It has significance because as we grow in holiness, we are more and more united to our human representative in heaven. This reality breaks down time and space in such a way that St. Paul can say, but God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. Ephesians 2, 4 through 7. The true Christian is so intimately united with Christ that our Lord's resurrection and triumphant entry into heaven are our victory too. For those who are the children of God, our inheritance is already secured by the Savior who died for us, the Savior who has already sacrificed himself on the cross and now makes that sacrifice a permanent reality in the very mirror center of existence, the Holy of Holies in heaven. What does that mean? That means that blessedly, in our times of weakness and failure, we simply need to close our eyes and remember. Remember our certain future, already being lived out by the firstborn Son of the new creation. And within that assured victory, no man or devil can touch us. of providing the divine blessing upon the people of God. We see both Aaron, the high priest, and the mysterious Melchizedek, and even God's humble servant who stands before you today, bless the people of God. But my announcement of God's blessing upon you only has power because Christ has poured down the supreme blessing of the Holy Spirit onto the church. As St. Peter tells us during his stunning Pentecost sermon, being therefore exalted at the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured out this that you yourselves are seeing and hearing. Acts 2:33. This spirit of true freedom from sin and death writes the peace treaty between God and man in our hearts and makes the reconciliation between rebellious creature and perfect creator more real than all the lies and deceptions of an evil and dying world. But as we learn again and again, we lust after those lies. We want them to be true. I am not surprised when people choose the world and its comforts over Christ and his cross. That should not surprise us. But when we see the opposite, when we see a busy woman come to church to pray on Monday, or a man give up some of his Saturday to help the poor, or when I look out in the congregation and see a human soul wrestling with the piercing dagger of God's truth, when that happens, I know the Holy Spirit is working. We know the Holy Spirit is working. And we rejoice. We rejoice to see men and women blessed by the living God, free from the dead works, giving living works. If you are Christ, God the Holy Spirit will not lose the battle for good and evil being waged in the earthly temple of your heart. There's no chance. He will not lose. What a comfort. Lastly, our great high priest is our heavenly intercessor, our mediator, who dwells in the heavenly holy of holies, constantly advocating for his people. He who died for us does not ever forget us or abandon us. By his stripes we are healed, and each of those stripes matter, just as each of us who make up his body matters. The most beautiful analogy for this heavenly act of continuous love and care comes to us from the Old Testament. It's the imagery Paul is using. It's the engraved on the stones, the names of the 12 tribes. The Israelite high priest would wear them on his shoulders while entering the earthly holy of holies, the meeting place between God and man. The high priest also wore the names of the 12 tribes on a breastplate so that the people he was advocating for were constantly on his shoulders and on his heart at all times. In the New Covenant, our great high priest, the great high priest we celebrate today, wears our names on his shoulders. He wears our names on his heart. He bears the weight of our lives of pain and woe and makes real Christian sacrificial love possible. As Christ prayed to his Father before his crucifixion and death in what is called his great high priestly prayer, I am not praying for the world, but for those whom you have given me, for they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I am glorified in them. John 17:9-10. Christ cherishes his people, and through his true disciples, our great high priest is glorified in the world. death of this evil world. And his prayers, just like his love, will not ever be poured out in vain. May his prayers, may his daily prayers for us be our anthem. May the words of our great high priest fill our souls with strength. And may the prayers of God's people, in pain and joy, in sadness and in victory, may those prayers fill every corner of heaven until they are no longer needed on this new earth. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Thine, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For all that is in heaven and in the earth is thine. Thine is the kingdom, O Lord, and thou art exalted as head above all. to give thanks for all men, we humbly beseech thee most mercifully to accept our alms and oblations, and to receive these our prayers, which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word, and live in unity and godly love. We beseech thee also so to direct and dispose the hearts of all Christian rulers, that they may truly and impartially administer justice to the punishment of wickedness and vice, and to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops, especially Mark, our Archbishop, and to the ministers, that they may, both by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people, give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence, they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. Especially Bill, Kim, Colby, Joseph, Joe, Judy, Suzanne, Jason, Rose, Sharon, Dawn, Fred, Dan, Ted, Nicholas, Linnell, Tarsitano, Briella, Dottie, Jerry, Pat, Britta, Mary Sue, Francis, Jesse, Janet, Charles, Carol, Joan, Lori, Peg, Danny. Holy are guardian angels in Lantana, Florida, and all who ask in our hearts before thee. And we also bless thy holy name, for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, beseeching thee to grant them continual growth in thy love and service, and to give us grace so to follow their good examples, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant this, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate.
Amen.
Ye who truly and earnestly repent of your sins, and are not in charity with your neighbors, and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God, and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith, and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to Almighty God, devoutly kneeling.
Almighty God,
Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Maker of all things, Judge of all men, we acknowledge and beware of our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and are humbly sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life,
through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Hear the comforting words our Savior Christ said unto all who truly turn to him. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. So God loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hear also what St. Paul said. This is a true saying and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Hear also what St. John said. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins.
The Lord be with you.
Remembrance of me. thy holy gifts which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make, having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most haughty thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same. And we most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and of thy almighty goodness, vouchsafe to bless and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that, by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here, we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that we and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and made one body with him, that he may dwell in us, and we in him. And although we are unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee,
O Father Almighty, Lord of heaven.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say,
that his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
who have duly received these holy mysteries, with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and is to assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are very members incorporate in the mystical body of thy Son, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom, by the merits of his most precious death and passion. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship, and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to him with thee and the Holy Ghost, be all honor and glory, world without end.
Amen.
O God, whose blessed Son was manifested that he might destroy the works of the devil, and make us the sons of God and heirs of eternal life, grant us, we beseech thee, that having this hope, we may purify ourselves even as he is pure, that when he shall appear again with power and great glory, we may be made like unto him in his eternal and glorious kingdom, where with thee, O Father, and thee, O Holy Ghost, he liveth and reigneth ever, one God, world without end.
Amen.
The peace of God which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen.
peace.
Thank you. one.
He was tough in school.
Very polite. He had a good
but we're done.
These are old.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.